Hi, my name is Ken Osterson. I wrote the microbiome prescription website, and today I want to go over a old part of it, which I've recently totally refactored based on requests from a couple of users. So it's calling using GI tests as opposed to 16S tests, and we should understand what the difference between them are. Dealing with the microbiome or the gut, there are basically two classes of tests. Sometimes they overlap between each other, but in general, we have a GI test, which is often prescribed by a physician or a naturalist. And generally, these tests are being used for 5, 10, 20, even 30 years. And they measured bacteria in a stool sample by growing them or by a variety of other mechanisms. Traditionally, they only report levels on two bacteria, and one of the historical reasons for that is that they calculate the bacteria by culturing, and many bacteria cannot be cultured. So that means they only can report on what they are able to identify. Usually, these are done in certified labs. They have one advantage to physician naturopath. They tend to make interpretations of something being high or low. Whether the interpretation is correct is a different question, but it means that the physician or naturopath doesn't have to somehow figure out. They have a canned answer ready to go. And a few of them, but not all of them, will make suggestions on how to correct imbalances and occasionally provide citations. Usually, and all the information is this for this bacteria, that for that bacteria. If you have three or four bacteria you wanting to shift, there's no attempt to reconciliate the suggestions, because some of the suggestions may actually have adverse effects for other bacteria, which means we have a little bit of a problem, as in things won't necessarily get corrected, and in some cases could make somebody worse. The tests are nice because they are easy to use. They are well promoted. The physician or naturopath gives you the test, sends in. The physician or naturopath gets the results, shared with you, get interpretation. Some cases, the actual test provider has an MD on staff, which means that we're having an MD to MD discussion, mutual respect between professionals. And MDs and naturopaths feel less alone in the wilderness of new information. The 16S test, which is doing a type of RNA test, has basically become popular starting with probably the first major provider of it. Actually, there's two of them. One is American Gut, which is still in business, came out of the University of California. And the other one is Ubiome, which also came out of California. Ubiome, unfortunately, has gone belly up. And both sets were basically done as direct-to-consumer. Sometimes you can refer to as people interested in doing biohacking, etc. Here's where things get different. Up above, GI steps may, in some cases, only report on a dozen. Other cases, two dozen or three dozen bacteria. The direct-to-consumer test, in some cases, and I have a sample which is uploaded, reports on up to 4,800 different bacteria. Okay, try asking a MD to name 4,800 different bacteria, and you'll get some rather blank looks. You may actually get them lucky to name 50 of them. Most of them, the 16S tests, are actually done in certified labs. Often the providers are middle people, as in they send out kits, which have been prepared, the kit comes back, it goes over to a certified lab. Some cases, several providers use the identical same lab, but everybody is branded with their own, just provider, that provider. Generally, the 16S test gives a count of the number of bacteria out of a million. That is interesting because the GI test sometimes gives the count per gram or the weight per gram or some other mechanism. So we have a difference between the tests in terms of how they report. And one of the problems is there's no easy way to convert from grams per milliliter or bacteria per milliliter to number of bacteria per million. Basically, it depends on the size of the bacteria. Some are big and some are small. The 16S test may interpret a few of them. In general, the interpretation is weak, and frequently they lack any citations as to the basis of it, or if they do, it's basically, I would call tokenism, nothing but a few items, and rarely gives suggestions for some bacterial imbalances which are supported with citations, as in medical studies. They will often give you advice, but that advice often may come from nutritionists and is general, pro forma, standard nutritionist suggestions, and may not actually be relevant to the bacterial shift. And again, as above, usually if there's multiple shifts, the suggestions are specific for one at a time and may occasionally be counterintuitive towards each other. 16S test generally requires a significant amount of self-education of the person interpreting it, which is a inhibits people doing so. And the provider rarely has an MD, etc. on staff, which means a physician or naturopath using it often are by their own in the wilderness, as some people would say. So those are the two basic types of tests. 16S test is what I have concentrated on my site. But I have circled back and says, okay, the GI test, a lot of people use it. A nutritionist or in the UK asked for me to revisit it, and I have proceeded and revisited it, and this talk should show you how it is now. Hopefully there will be motivation to evolve it more, but right now this is a good enhancement. Okay, let's take a look what the GI test looks at, because the first issue, it becomes a bit of a messy. Every test reports differently. And here we have one test that shows nicely on, names the bacteria and gives a percentage, which is good. A percentage can be converted into per million easy enough and indicates whether or not the value is high, normal, or low. And it's all visual. The no information on how to determine the range or what in fact the range is. Second one down is gives another example, and you notice that it's scaled. It's scaled between 0 and 20. So we're not dealing with actual counts. This is a scaling of whatever the result is over into their standards, with the 20 being the highest and 0 being the lowest, and where you fall in there. Again, no information on the basis, and in this case, not even what percentage. A third one gives you the result of how many, and here it's a bit interesting because this, I believe, is estimated counts per some other unit, and it's not a percentage, and converting back and forth. I've tried a couple of times, and there's no converting this type of data over to the type of per million information we use with 16S. Now, when we come to using the input page, which I'll be showing shortly, whoever is reading the test has to make a determination. If it's normal in the report, actually, you don't bother entering. That's the default setting. Is it low, medium low, or extremely low? High, medium high, or very high? Again, it's subjective. You take a look at whatever mechanisms they do, and you come up to your own interpretation of how to do it. I give you six possible values. The values are basically used to weigh different bacteria one way or the other in terms of should we increase this one or decrease this one and how important it is. So again, we work from their charts. You have to interpret into six, seven classes. Extremely low, low, very low, low, normal, high, very high, and extremely high. So the task is to focus on three types of individuals in this presentation. The first one is the client who got results, see issues when they do something. I've often seen on some social media groups, they got a result back, a bacteria was high, and it's absolutely n and they and the person is pleading for help because there's absolutely nothing in the report on how to adjust or correct the bacteria they are high in. Which means, okay, you have created anxiety for the user. Anxiety will alter the microbiome, generally in not a favorable method, and you have basically left them out to dry. And so I'm going to be showing how to enter and get suggestions for this person. The second one, which is basically going to be the same process, is for an interested client, one who wants a bit more information, or a medical professional who wants to be better informed, not well informed, just better. And we'll show you how to enter data, save the data on the site, and get suggestions and different ways of getting suggestions. By saving it on the site, it basically opens up advanced suggestions for the person. And you can, if you're a naturopath or MD, you can have 25 different clients on your account, which is fine, no particular problem, etc. The last level I'm going to go through is a medical professional or client who wants to be better educated. I'll show you how to do all the above. But because of being at the professional level with the site, you will get shown all the medical citations and links to them, which are the basis for the suggestions. In other words, you can find out, this isn't me saying you should do this or that. You can go and read the original source material. Make the only evaluation, is this good or bad source material? Some cases, the information, unfortunately, I must admit it, comes from veterinary studies because they often are interested in improving production. So often they do tests on one or another feed additive and see what the impact is on the microbiome. Which makes it nice. However, whether or not you want to include that information or not include it is a subjective choice. The amount of information out there is actually pretty sparse. So generally, I've taken some liberties, including anything which feels like it's probably will be relevant. And if you try to say, oh, it's just human studies, well, then we hit more problems, such as just as on Chinese population, European population, and African population. All three have different diets. All three will have different responses to a medication or a change of diet, and often the responses will be different. So we are dealing with more complexities and little knowledge, hence we have to do some punting, which I refer to a little bit more sophisticatedly as artificial intelligence. Okay, let's hop stop now and go over to the walkthrough. Okay, we're on the website and all the GI stool type tests are under other lab analysis. Just click there and you will see a list there. And people, if you are dealing with a test which isn't on the list, you've got two choices. Send me a copy of the test and I will, at no charge, enter the data to be able to do it, assuming we don't have a preposterous number of items in there. Or you could go over and do the generic. For example, list all the families imported and go through and list all of the bacteria family. So you could just say, okay, this family is high, this family is low, which is one way of doing it. Or you could actually go to a specific test. For example, let's suppose we go over and do day two, and here we have what they are testing. And what we're going to do is we're just going to go and do a few things. For example, I'm going to say we have low bifidobacterium, we have very low adolescence, and we have very low there, which implies that other bifidobacterium probably is there, but those are the ones that are there. And we're going to toss something in high, and let's go over to, let's suppose we have high bifidobacteria. So we now have the items transferred from the sheet there. Down at the bottom, you can enter an email, enter the patient's email, date is taken, add information, and then do analysis. If an email is given, the data will be saved. Otherwise, this is walkthrough. I'm not going to do this first time because what it does is it just basically goes directly over into the suggestions. Here we have suggestions. We see the name of the lab. It's day two. We have here classification of different things to do. For example, I say, okay, what I'm really interested in is prebiotics. I'm there. Let's exclude vitamins and stuff, herbs, diet type. Okay, and now we have over here grayed out a variety of features available. We do include commercial probiotic mixtures, and there's a mechanism where if your favorite probiotic isn't in the list, you can add it to it, and with that I'll do it. Now you can specify how many items to show on the list. I'm going to up this one to 30 just for the fun of it. And you click and show suggestions. Voila, it's done fast. And you notice it goes and dumps the information you enter back to the screen. So you can go and review that. It also goes and spells out what the choices are. And generally, this particular screen only says low or high, doesn't give you very low, very high. There's never screen, which for the next level up does show that information. And now it goes through and gives suggestions. First thing you do is you see the list of things which will improve it. Over here, you have a list of things which will inhibit it. And everything is scaled by a number with one being the most, and it's scaled based on the number of studies showing that it helps. So the more studies, the higher the number, the less studies, the lower the number. Some cases it's a singleton study and that's it. Other cases there are many, many studies. You also notice that I have a measuring stick here, and if you click that, and you will see that it will go and give the medical, in this case clinical studies, and how much is used. So it will give you suggestions as to how much the dosage should be. These are studies which were being used in clinical studies, so whoever was doing it decided 2 grams per day was appropriate dosage. If there are actual completed studies, then it will show that and what amount they used for the studies, and if it was effective in causing their anticipated change or not. So makes life a lot easier for nutritional, etc., so that I don't have to try figuring out what the dosage is. And as time goes on, I'll get more dosages located and added. Inulin, prebiotics, there goes down, etc. So we have there cacao there. So you have a list of everything that will help the probably helps the low bifid. I know many of these recognized are common for low bifidal bacteria to increase, and other things hopefully would cause it to decrease. We have down the bottom commercial probiotics, and it goes and lists any. It also gives a list of ones which have mixed impact. And mixed impact means that the probiotic mixture will help some of these shifts, but will also cause some of the shifts to go the wrong way. Hence, mixed impact is usually dangerous to take unless there is a compelling reason to do it. No known impact means we have no information at all on whether these items impact the shifts you're trying to do. And here again, this is a combination of weighing all the stuff together, and it's not scaled to one, it just sort of tally everything up. And in this case, we have one particular one which has a big whopping big one. Then we have a couple there. And in this case, I was so nice, kind to many people, and put the fact that it is available in Australia. So if you're not in Australia, you may have trouble getting it. Others like Bob Florian, which is Deutsch from Germany, you can actually order in the US and other spots around. So the availability is always a interesting challenge. And we also have the bottom have flavonoids, which is many of the studies meant were done looking at what flavonoids helped. As in, they did a flavonoid extraction applied to a cell culture or to a mouse or in some cases to humans and measured the changes. And what we have here is the flavonoids that will help and the potential impact on it. So you can go and say, okay, item may or may not be up here because this is based on studies with this, with the whole food. These are based on the studies with flavonoid foods, which means we look going from a flavonoid study to the food. So the food may not have been tested, but the flavonoid has, and then miscellaneous information are done. So that basically covers it. So you just go in there, information is there, print it off. If you print it off, I suggest you expand everything out up so you can see all the information, come back later. And upload date is here so you know when it was done. This is a walkthrough came from the text box. If you're doing it for a patient, put in their name. When you do it this way, nothing is saved to the website, so you are able to just get there, print it, and that's it. No particular HIPAA compliance issue, just straightforward. However, if you want to come back and visit later, tough luck. You can, of course, go back here because I opened up in a new tab intentionally, is go back and says, okay, what I really want to do is I want to take a look at no probiotics. I want to take a look at herbs and spices. Let's forget that. So I'm taking another selection of types of modifiers and saying, okay, show me. And there we have, and we have again things are ranked as things that will help or things that will hurt. For example, here we find that a lot of the B vitamins appear to be harmful. Some of the herbs also appear harmful. Seaweed, harmful, which is a little bit surprised because seaweed has become popular as a magic cure-all. Okay, and then we have noni magnesium, zinc, etc. So we have a very good detail of items and the relative ranking on it. Okay, so that's end of part one. Now, let's flip back and take a look at the second one. We are doing an interested client or medical professional who wants to be medical better performed. Okay, so let's go back and take a look at how we do this bit of magic. So we back to the report. We mark it out the same way as we did. Things are low, very low, etc., or high. And now we basically want to do a couple things. We actually want to put in a little bit more information. And let's suppose the sample was taken on the 11th of on the 31st day in 2020. And you should put in your email address. And in this case, I'm going to put in ken.lassesen@gmail.com. Please don't spam me. And I'm going to put in examples at example.com. So I've put in a bogus email address, members example, and put my own here. Generally, because of HIPAA compliance and openness and good practice, if this was a patient, information, you should put their email here. It will send them email saying, does this data, their data has been uploaded to the site. The email gives information on how they can remove the data if they are unhappy about it. So it's just being polite to your patient and also allowing your patient to come in and explore. Okay, so it's a CISO walkthrough, and now I do analysis. Oops. I love it when it catches me on silliness. Okay. And it's hopefully off doing analysis. And there's a slight delay here because it is busy emailing stuff. And now we're over day two. And because we have an email in it, you will actually get emails coming shortly to your desktop. Here is an example of the email. It specifies who it was for and gives you information including how to link, etc. So everything is spelled out there. And we also have an example of the email to the person. Email to person specify who uploaded it and sent to the person. So both members are notified always. Good best practices for protecting personal information, etc. So that's there. Now, when you get it, you can go in and proceed to click in. By clicking this link right here, you're logging on, so I'll click that. And now we are in there. Just in case we have some 16S samples, which is fine. Or we go to other lab samples. And there we have day two is sitting there. Add date, sample date. This is a walkthrough. Ability to delete. If you want to do a review of what is in the samples, just click here to open. And here in case you will see what was entered and using the same measurements as your enter, so you can just do a spot check on that. So we have that. We now have ability to enter never samples. If you do an adventure day two, just takes you back there nice and easy to see if you have any look for the look for this again. But more importantly, if you go over to suggestions, you will find that we have some changes. These things are no longer disabled. Our citations are based on this stud is we keep all basic suggestions being as literal as possible. If this item affects Bifidobacterium, then only the Bifidobacterium will be cited in the database. However, we do also know that Bifidobacterium is a child of Bifidobacterium. So the question is, do you want to also include any information we have about the parent or the child? If you are dealing with something like protobacteria, there's a bunch of different children, and we have studies indicating that some child bacteria in that hierarchy of bacteria is influenced. So we can go in here and proceed to mark here and that this link here should only show up at the professional level, but I believe you get a yes. So I've logged onto an account which has professional level. This one will usually be grayed out. So now we can go over and show suggestions. So now we have gone and we have added in more items to it. And some cases it'll be similar and other cases it will be different. And the reason is because of the additional studies which we ensure apply because it affects Bifidobacterium longum. Therefore, our concern for Bifidobacterium, if it helps that one, it may help longum. Doesn't always happen, but it does it. And we see something like nonies down low, chart, artichokes, etc. Everything's the same as before. I didn't select the commercial probiotics, so that doesn't show up. We have our flavonoids here, which is a much bigger list than the other ones. We still have nuts and pomegranates at the top, but we have a bunch of other things which now comes in by association by the parent or by the child. So that is basically it. So you now have the choice of all of the information, and you are able to be more broad in your thing. Last thing I'm going to do is click this one, which is at a professional level. The account I logged on was already preset professional, which is say so suggestions. And now we go down, we have the same thing as before, but we have a little button here. And this little button is very important. When we click it, it will go and gives all the citation it was based on. So we have, in this case, we have 29 citations listed, and you can see a link to the summary. If the article is published as a HTML article somewhere, or the publication, and there we have the information sitting there, which means you can start spending your evenings reading and reading and reading ad nauseum. So the professional level is intended to allow people to be able to review all the information. It means you basically have a professional interest. You're willing to spend the time to start reading lots of articles and do the basis of it. For example, let's do one more. Let's do aspirin over here. And you will find here is, we have three studies dealing with aspirin, and all of them are specific to what it impacts, which is nice. Now let's go back and see if we can find melatonin, which is interesting because it is on the remove list. Same citation. That citation is a key one. Let's go up and here, and then here we have what I was looking for. Something, it decreases protobacteria, increases bifidobacterium, and because we had high protobacteria and low bifidobacterium, then it means that this particular substance is a sweet spot. In other words, it deals with both issues. The more issues you have, the more complicated it is. But you can now go and see the citations, read the citations, see what you are interested in. Again, just an unusual caveat warning. For example, just as it is a species, sometimes the studies are at a strain level, and usually I do not encode the data for strain specific. Just not enough information. And the last part is, if you are a GI test provider, we have an API available for you to share your report to the site automatically. You have a button on your website, user clicks it, data sent over. They then get an email back saying the data has been transferred over and how they can delete the data if you don't want it there. But they can now go over to the site and get suggestions, which means you know, leaving the person out in the wilderness, not knowing how to deal with something which is too high. You are providing them information. Now, there's no cost whatsoever for transferring the data across. So it becomes a extra bonus to your user, which costs you nothing, and just put a button there and away it goes. You can also, if you want, or if you need to, obtain information from the site by a web API call and get the information back to you, your site, and then you can process it as you wish. Now, that is being done as a service. And I have a series of pages describing it. I'm video recording how I assemble the data, and the data is massive. And believe me, you can try replicating the data, But I think you'll find that the labor costs is going to be significant. I use AI techniques to filter data. I have, I think, last count, 28 gigabytes of summaries from PubMed, which have been processed through a variety of AI tools to identify key ones and then take that those key ones and code it. There's a video showing you how exactly I did it. But what we have then is we have API, you make a call and you get back information, for example, what the URL is, the their digital address, what the logic is, whether or not it impacts, etc. And over on the right, you will find information about the pricing model, which is generally on a per call basis, but you can save the data over on yours. Advantage of doing it is periodically you may either want to refresh data, or if you're using a suggestion to make a new reference is showing up, in which case you probably want to pull in suggestions API, which is the same logic which I use for making the suggestions here, and over suggestions API. There's a list of types which API will return. You specify what types you want, and now I proceed saying, okay, here it is. Here is a suggestion. Does it dysregulate or regulate or normalizes the bacteria which you send over in your definition? In this case, we have a shift being -1, so that means that is a negative value. And there, and this one is already set up for the type of information you're using. You can modify it for your algorithms by, in terms of modifying your data for all algorithms by scaling the shift, be it any number, any real number, or you can use all suggestions, or you can go and grab the data and apply the logic yourself to, with your own algorithm. So at this point in time, I think I'm going to shut up. And that's basically it. If you're interested in sharing, please contact me. Remember, sharing your data to the site is free, no cost whatsoever. Some people who do share are appreciative, and they give donations to cover running costs. So, and the running costs are at the present totally covered by donations. So, nothing out of pocket. I have my regular day job and I prefer not to pay more income tax. And you, if you're interested in obtaining information from the site, then take a look at it. We can give you a trial API call, but research as a service has a commercial value and it's a significant commercial value. Hence, I will unfortunately or fortunately, depending if you're talking to my wife or not, be billing for that type of calls. Okay, but the billing rate is expected to be a fraction of what it will cost you to replicate the data or anybody else to replicate the data. So I'm first in with the biggest data and the best offer. Shh, I'm not Amazon, but I'm striving to go in that direction. I did work for Amazon for a while, so I have absorbed that culture. Okay, I'll shut up, or else my ex-teacher in me is just going to keep gabbing away for hours and hours.